Amigos, ¿cómo están? Una nueva edición aquí de Auto 060 en Cristina Radio Network. Tenemos un show en que vamos a presentarles la historia de un documental que se llama 32 Hours and 7 Minutes con su productora y directora general. Vamos a hablar también con Simon Turner de Land Rover sobre la nueva Range Rover Sport 2014 y vamos a cambiar un poco, no es necesariamente de autos, vamos a hablar de una motocicleta, la Can-Am Spyder, y de un Sea-Doo, esas motos de agua que son una cuestión muy, muy, muy divertida, y vamos a escuchar un poco la relación que tiene esto un poco con los autos, así que si tiene motor y va rápido lo pueden escuchar aquí en Auto 060. Así que sin perder tiempo vamos de inmediato a la entrevista con Corey Walls, directora y productora de 32 Hours and 7 Minutes.
So a few weeks ago, I was at an event in California, driving back to the airport, and I get the huge luck of getting to know Corey, and I ask her, among other things, what are you doing and all that, and then like I ask her, what are you doing before this, and like if someone tells you like I did laundry or I washed my car or something, she says I did a movie. I mean, like, really? And then like we started talking about it. So Corey, thank you for the opportunity of talking to you again. And so let's talk about this little project that you've been working for about 10 years, right?
Yeah, 10 years. Thank you for having me on your show.
So tell us about it. 32 hours and 7 minutes. What does that mean?
32 hours and 7 minutes is the record from New York to L.A. in a car, set in 1983 by my dad's best friend in the very last race of what was known to be the Cannonball.
Yeah.
It was the last, it was the successor race of the Cannonball called the U.S. Express, and it was the last sort of balls-to-the-wall underground car race.
Okay, let's go back a little bit to the history, because when you mentioned Cannonball to most people, they remember another movie that has to do a little bit with this one, but not really, right?
Correct. So everyone knows Burt Reynolds in Cannonball Run, which was released in 1981. And what most people don't know was that that movie was based on the real event. The screenwriter, Brock Yates, was actually the mastermind behind the Cannonball race, and he wrote about it in Car and Driver magazine in the 70s.
Yeah, and this race, the original one, obviously it was illegal, right? Because to make that time, you have to speed a little bit.
Just a little.
Yeah.
Yeah, the thing that I like to point out to people when they hear about it, because some people get a little upset. What? You were racing across, you know, people raced across the country really fast. That's dangerous. But Brock Yates started this event because his point was that it's not speed that kills, it's bad driving. And he said, look, I'm going to prove it to you. I'm going to race across this country as fast as I can, and you're not even going to know about it.
Wow. And back in those days, how was the organization of those original races?
You had to be invited to the race, so he had to know that you
and
were
keep
someone...
keep the secret, I guess,
yeah,
beforehand.
Yeah, he had to trust you, he had to trust your driving, that you were someone who could handle a car at speed. So these were guys who had a lot of seat time, women too. You were invited to the race between, you know, a dozen to upwards of four dozen cars were invited every year, two drivers per car.
And the original ran for how many years?
Five. It went five times between 71 and 79.
And apparently the relations to the other movie, the Burt Reynolds movie, is that Yates got a contract, right, to do that movie or participate into the production of that, and then he had to stop doing it?
Correct. So from what I've been told and what I've read is that in 79, he did the very last Cannonball. Before that, it was 75. And I think between 75 and 79, he was getting this deal with Hollywood.
Okay.
He's a writer. He, you know, and all writers, maybe not all writers, but most writers would love to pen a screenplay and go to Hollywood.
I think all of us do, but nobody's brave enough to do it.
Right. So he was able to get this deal, and the racers that had been involved in the race back then and knew him said, well, you know, Hollywood's not going to invest their money in you if there's a risk. You know, you need to stop doing the race because you can't. What if something bad had happened in one of the races, right? So you've killed your idea for a movie. But anyway, he wrote this screenplay and did his last Cannonball in 79, and I've read from his book and other accounts that a lot of the crazy stuff that went to the movie really happened in the 79 race. No, I mean, some things didn't happen. It was completely...
Some are exaggerated in the movie, you're trying to say.
Yes, it's a very exaggerated movie. It's kind of silly. It's fun. People have fond memories, great memories of watching that movie, so...
Yeah. And then, so where is the idea for you to make this new movie, like the real thing, came from?
Well, good question. It came from this memory I had as being a 10-year-old and finding out that this man, who was my dad's best friend, kind of like an uncle to me, had set a record in this race. And when I found out that he had done this and my parents were happy about it and their friends were happy about it, it just blew sort of the lid off my concept at that point as a 10-year-old of what life was going to be. You know, you're taught to color in the lines and show up on time and do follow these rules and guidelines. And I realized at that point that he stepped outside the bounds. He did something that was not supposed to be a good thing. It was frowned upon because it was against the law, but yeah, he did something that was so amazing, and it was very inspiring to me as a 10-year-old to just know that life had all these avenues and opportunities for you to take, even though it might not be accepted in the norm, but they were good things. It wasn't that you were doing bad things, you know.
Yeah.
It was very inspiring to me as a 10-year-old to know that.
As a 10-year-old, I'm not surprised about that, because, I mean, you're pretty alert, 10-year-old.
I don't know, I guess. I think driving and being on the road was a big part of my life. Just, I spent a lot of time on the freeway as a kid, so...
So then, like, the process of gathering all the information and meeting with, I guess, the people who are still alive from those days, and that's how it started? It took you, like, so long to produce this movie?
Yeah, I mean, it took me a good while to find people. I had a producer working with me at that point, and we had to track everyone down, and I was literally going off napkins from bars and the restaurants where the banquet was held for the very last race. People would write their name and their phone number on a cocktail napkin and hand it to my dad's friend. And so he brought me a sack of photographs and business cards and pieces of paper from 1983, and that's all I had to go on.
Wow, that's amazing. I already seen the movie. I'm not going to say much about it, because I think people who are listening really have to watch this movie, because it's pretty amazing. And as you said, some of all of us writers want to write a movie, but I think all of us, all the automotive journalists and people who really like cars, want to do what you did in that movie. Not the movie, but like you are in the movie too, right?
Yes, I tell you the story, and I occupy a very important seat.
Wow, so incredible. So the movie was released earlier this year?
Yep.
But it's an independent movie, so it's not in big film festivals or anything like that yet?
No, not yet. It's completely independent. We had a list of a bunch of guys who've been following the progress of the movie for many years, and just before Christmas, I actually released it privately to them first, because these are the hardcore car guys who've been waiting, and they just had sent me messages for years saying, like, hey, we're behind you, just make it great, man, make it great. And so I felt it. They really needed the first crack at seeing it.
Okay, so now you said it's not released in film festivals or movie theaters. Where can people find it?
Oh, they can find it on my website, 32hours7minutes.com.
Yeah, and then what will they find there? They find the actual movie, they find a clip, or what is it?
Yeah, they'll find a clip of the first 2.5 minutes of the film. They'll find the original trailer that we released. And it'll take them to our shopping cart where they can buy the DVD. Right now, it is on DVD. I think the next step we will take is we're going to do streaming online.
Yeah. Yeah, that's going on now with YouTube and all those things. So it's a great opportunity to, like, expose your movie to more people, I guess. So do you want to give up anything about the movie or not?
Give up, well...
A little bit of the story, a little bit more about
sure,
a little more detail.
Sure. So it's... Basically, I was going to cut the movie up into pieces. The first third of the movie is me taking you back into 1983 and giving you the history just on the race and what people, I think, don't realize of what happened. Very soon after that, there's some suspicions about this record that was set about how it was not real. And well, I needed to prove that this record was real, because I believe with all my heart that my dad's friend Doug set this record in 83. And the only way to do it is to get in a car and see if you can match or beat that time. So the second two-thirds of the film is we get into a BMW M5 and race across the country to try to break the record.
That's amazing. And going back to the original record, what was the speed limit, the speed average that they had to complete the original 32 and 7-minute record?
We have footage of them saying at the finish, they said it was 89.897 miles per hour. So just under 90 miles an hour average for a day and a half.
Yeah, when you think about that, that's like, I mean, if you do a little bit of the math, that's very, very fast. Because that includes, I guess, how many stops did they did for gas?
Oh, they did.
And go to the bathroom,
I believe,
guess?
They did six. I think they did six gas stops, and they got a ticket.
Wow.
They got a speeding ticket, yeah, in Ohio.
So that probably that makes a lot of people believe that it wasn't possible. So
yeah.
Anyway, I mean, the movie is about 32 hours and 7 minutes, but here we only have like 10 minutes. So thank you very much again for the information. Congratulations on the movie. I've seen it twice already, I have to say. The second time was much better than the first one. I enjoyed really a lot. So again, what the website, please?
32 hours, 7 minutes. The 32 and the 7 are numerical. 32hours7minutes.com, and thank you so much for having me.
No, thank you, Cara. Well, listen, thank you. I mean, it's the great thing about this job is traveling and meeting people like you.
Well, likewise.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Pues ahí tienen la directora Corey Wallace de la película 32 Hours and 7 Minutes. Se las recomiendo de verdad. Es fascinante a todo el mundo que le gustan los autos, la velocidad. Y seamos un poco honestos, romper los límites de velocidad, yo creo que la van a disfrutar mucho. 32hoursand7minutes.com con Corey Wallace. Cuando regresemos vamos a hablar del test drive que hicimos con la Land Rover Range Rover Sport. Ahí sí, respetando todos los límites de velocidad, estuvimos en el sur de San Francisco probando esta nueva SUV de Land Rover, así que no se vayan, que cuando regresemos aquí en Auto 060, la Land Rover Sport 2014.